Usher. I met her in Philly and her name was Brown Sugar. See, we be making love constantly. That's why my eyes are a shade blood burgundy. The way that we kiss is unlike any other way that I be kissing. When I'm kissing, what I'm missing, won't you listen? Brown sugar, babe, I guess high up your love, I don't know how to behave. When you're close to me, you love me right down to my knees. And whenever you let me hit it, sweet like honey when it comes to me. Skin is caramel with the cocoa eyes. Even got a big sister by the name of Chocolate. Brown sugar, babe, I guess high off of love, don't know how to behave. Sugar got me open, now I want some more. Always down for all my nauseous wine, but I think I'm here to solo. Hope my niggas don't mind. Stick out my tongue and I'm about ready to hit this pretty, pretty bitty with persistence. Yo, I don't think y'all hit. Brown sugar, babe, I guess high off of love, don't know how to behave.
I'm jumping up and down the floor. My hat is an animal, and once there was an animal. It had a son that mowed the lawn. The son was an okay guy. They had a pet dragonfly. The dragonfly ran away, but it came back with a story to say.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon.
We all go out together.
Wow, no one's excited. Good afternoon, everyone.
Like a rock.
That's
band.
A little bit more Galaxy Life energy. One more time for Galaxy Life. Good afternoon. Fantastic. We want to welcome each and every one of you all to today's panel, which is Deadline Hollywood, the GOAT, which is being broadcasted live via the live broadcasting mode on the Samsung Galaxy S6 Edge Plus. So if you have that device or one of our Samsung Galaxy Note 5s, you have that feature available. So definitely pull it out, live broadcasting via on YouTube today. Today, I want you all to help me to introduce and to welcome our moderator, which is Editor-in-Chief of Deadline Hollywood, Mr. Mike Fleming himself, who will be joined by GOAT Director Andrew Neil and stars of the film, Mr. Ben Schnetzer, Brad Land, Kristen Vachon, David Hinojosa, and none other than Mr. Nick Jonas himself. If you can get on your feet, join in a round of applause and welcome these folks in.
Right then. Welcome everyone. Now, GOAT is director Andrew Neil's adaptation of a memoir by Brad Land that explores these themes of masculinity, brotherhood, and the male bonding at college frats. Now, Ben Schnetzer plays Brad, and Joe Jonas plays his older, tougher brother, Brad.
Does he?
Wait, what? What did I do?
Wrong Jonas.
What?
It's the wrong Jonas. It's okay, though. He'll be here in a couple hours. You can ask him.
Oh, my God.
This is about brotherhood, so actually...
Yes. Yeah. Well, my apologies.
It's okay.
So anyway, we were... Okay, so he plays his older, tougher brother, Brett. Now, after being brutalized, demoralized, and robbed by thugs in a random attack, Brad tries to regain his self-worth and his connection to his brother by pledging Brett's college fraternity. You get all that? Now, there's a promise of brotherhood and security in being part of that decadent frat lifestyle, but it only comes at the end of a humiliating and sadistic hazing process that leaves Brad and his brother questioning everything, particularly after the frat's Hell Week hazers target Brad's delicate roommate, played by Danny Flaherty. Now, the movie's gritty and harsh, but it is a perfect Sundance movie because it stays with you, it asks tough questions, and it introduces a young cast of actors I'm sure you're going to be seeing more of in the future, including breakout performances by these two guys here. Now, I've got Andrew Neil here, who directed the provocative South by Southwest film King Kelly, and he wrote the script with Mike Roberts from a draft David Gordon Green wrote 10 years ago. So now, Andrew, I want to start with you. Can you tell me why was this story so important for you to tell?
Lord of the Flies is one of my favorite books. So, I mean, I think that was a starting place. I'm just kind of interested in the underbelly of human behavior and fraternity culture, which all mainly happens, at least the hazing problem, process happens in private. So it was sort of a perfect fit.
Well, now, all right. So, now, what were you looking for when you began casting this particular young group of actors?
I mean, I just wanted really good actors. I mean, that's what you always want, right? So, we cast Ben. Susan Schottmaker is the casting director who I trust implicitly to find young talent. And then, you know, Nick got submitted and we saw his picture, like, whoa, they really look like brothers. We got him in and, you know, he did a great job in the reading and the rest is history, you know? And then all the other kids, you know, they were just really good, gung-ho young guys who were just, you know, on the make. And so everyone was really motivated and willing to, you know, go all the way.
Well, now, you know, spend a moment. Talk about some of the hazing practices that the author went through. And what were some that you left out?
Actually, you know, that's a tough question. I'm so lost in all of the various versions because first there's the book, and then there's David's script, and then there's our revision. You know, I think the one that is the most central to the book and in the movie was what happens out at the cabin. absolutely. They get locked in the cabin, and then they have that moment when they come out at the end. So, I mean, in general, you know, this movie portrays hazing that's pretty brutal. It gets more brutal than this. Yeah, I don't know.
Okay.
Did I answer your question?
Yeah. So now, so for Ben and Nick, so now there's a macho element to wanting to belong and improve yourself, just like the characters. Talk about what it was like to shoot those scenes of humiliation, and even maybe even there was bonding between the guys who it was inflicted upon and the guys who were perpetrating it. Just give us a sense of what it was like to be in that environment.
Yeah, on the days that we shot the big hazing stuff, Andrew separated the brothers and the pledges and gave us each kind of a debrief and a talking to. But he made sure to make us feel safe. We knew that we trusted each other. We trusted Andrew. And I think that allowed us to really go for it. And everybody was game. Everybody was very... excited about kind of digging deep and getting as real as we could. I don't know what it was like for you guys on your end, but it was challenging, but it was rewarding. Definitely, it's an important part of the story.
Yeah, I mean, I think it'd be borderline offensive to sit back and say from the side of doing the hazing rituals that it was exhausting. But there was an element of emotional exhaustion that set in. You know, because we really did build a strong bond, especially Ben and I, you know, filming the movie, but also in the prep work. And so watching someone go through that became a very real experience for me, which then played itself out in the film as the arc as well. You know, and so I think it's one of those things that opens your eyes and really makes you think and gives you some real perspective.
Now, Nick, now you know, we know you obviously... For your singing career, even if some older guys screw up the members of the band.
That's cool.
But now you have been carving out a grounded identity as an actor, you know, with Kingdom. And this is a real breakout turn. Describe the conflicts that Brett dealt with that made this role sort of irresistible.
It was a lot of things. I think. You know, I read the script for Goat around the same time I started shooting Kingdom, season one, and character there is incredibly complex and kind of internalizes his emotions and what he's going through, kind of playing this story arc out over the last couple seasons of not being okay with who he is. And so I think the thing I was most drawn to about Goat was the idea to do something polar opposite. Brett is really so far from my character in Kingdom, and pretty outspoken and life of the party at the beginning of the film, and then that sort of shifts when he gains the perspective. But I think the thing that was attractive was the brotherhood element, which I connect to in a big way, but also you know, the message behind this. And speaking to Andrew the first time we spoke, he was very clear on his intention and what he wanted to see for the final product and what he wanted people to think when they left the theater.
Now, Ben, this movie kind of pivots on your character's, this awful assault that he suffers and his need to find an outlet again to regain his self-worth and his sense of masculinity and confidence. Tell us a little bit about your character's journey.
Well, it's interesting. I think, you know, the context of the film is a fraternity, but I hope it provokes a discussion, this film, about masculinity in general and rites of passage in general, because it's something that I think a lot of young men feel a need to embark on. There needs to be a definitive moment in which you become a man, you go through this gauntlet. And I think it's something everybody can relate to to one degree or another, not always to the extreme of pledging a fraternity, but I mean, Brad's memoir is it was all there. It was a real resource for me. And so I just spent a lot of time with that. And then once it was time to shoot, it was time to let all that go and just try and be open. And
Now, Andrew, you've said that this movie is partially a horror film. And What were the challenges of depicting this kind of relentless brutality without glorifying it or painting these bad guys too simplistically, since all of them are basically trying to navigate all that testosterone and insecurity and, you know, balance with conscience on their way to becoming men?
I mean, you know, quite honestly, it's hard to look at that behavior portrayed honestly and not be horrified. I mean, I think what a lot of college movies do, and comedies, and that's fair enough because they're comedies, is they just make light of everything and it all seems funny and they allow the audience to laugh. We didn't really do that. I mean, I think there's awkward laughter sometimes when people are watching it, but you know, by and large, like, we let these guys go. Sometimes we'd start the hazing and I'd give them a couple key moments, like, here's an activity, here's an activity, here's an activity, go. And then we just let them go for like 5 minutes. And I wouldn't step in, you know? We just wait until it was pushed right to the limit, you know, where I started to feel like, okay, maybe this is unsafe, or maybe they're running out of steam. Both actually the guys who are hazing and the guys being hazed, because I think it was traumatic to be in both roles. So yeah, I mean, like, in terms of making it a horror film, it's horrifying, you know, and we just tried to make that visceral. I think probably, you know, maybe we make light of this stuff in our culture because we're uncomfortable about it. I think all this stuff is hidden away because it's the darker part of who we are as human beings, all this violence and stuff that's inside of us. And seeing that when it comes out in an ugly way and really when it's funneled and encouraged is scary. So yeah, I approached the middle part of the movie as if it was a horror film, you know? And hopefully there was always this feeling of suspense, like, what are they gonna do to them next, you know?
Well, maybe was there a moment in that movie that benefited from you letting the guys go? And was there a moment in the production where you felt that that they went too far, maybe somebody got hurt, or an actor was maybe a little traumatized?
No, I don't think so. I think it was always good. I think when you push things to the limit, you always get good things. And I think with actors too, I you know, that's why it was great working with these guys and the rest of the guys in the cast. They were just willing to go all the way in there. And that's what you have to do to get good material, especially when you're dealing with subject matter like this. There was one moment where I think one of the kids said maybe he needed, one of the guys being hazed said he needed to tap out for a while when we're inside the cabin. And actually, I took him aside and, are you okay? You can definitely step out. And actually, he kind of got back up and went back in. And I said, all right, if you're cool with it. So, yeah. It was always I hope it was always a safe environment, which I think that's...
Yeah, it was, definitely.
That's how you get good acting. Like, you want to yeah, make people feel safe.
And now, what was it like the moment after he says cut, and Nick not so much, because you were kind of on the sidelines observing, but, you know, when you were basically getting crapped on or peed on or whatever, what was that moment like? And you're with these actors who obviously are looking to prove themselves convincingly, but at the same time, you know, you guys, I'm sure, bonded. So what is that like when he says cut after a hard scene?
It actually was a real bonding experience. I mean, right when he said cut, we all just wanted to go take a shower because various condiments and all sorts of accoutrement was
That's right. You guys got really bitchy at one point. I remember that.
Showers at the cabin. We had to get hosed off in the back.
Yeah, they started complaining, and I was like, frat leader style. I was like, no, we're not going to clean you off. You know? But we did. We did, of course. Yeah.
Now, the nice thing is, as you guys progress into bigger movies, they'll actually provide showers and not just a hose. So.
Yeah, but see, that's where shit starts.
We needed the hose. That was an element of the bonding.
The problem with all this shit is that everyone wants a huge motor home, and then they don't want you to see their hip without some kind of thing on it, and, you know, they want like a thing covered up, and then that's why the movies often just go to shit, because like that's what happens. And actors
just touched on a sensitive subject, right?
They're not going to go to shit for me. No,
I don't know.
So you're saying this is a pure moment right now, and basically these guys are going to be corrupted starting tonight even. And the rest of their careers, it's not going to be the same.
Well, I mean, I hope they actually they continue to hold that. I mean, that's what these guys do, you know? They say to actors, look, you're not going to have all this stuff you usually want because this is an independent film and there's no money to make it. And so you have to come out here and do what you really do and what you're supposed to do. You don't come out here to have all this stuff with you and get, you know, carried around on a litter, you know? Like, it's ridiculous. Like, we're supposed to be acting here, you know? So, I mean, and that's why a lot of these films, I think, that Killer makes are good because that's what they encourage.
You know? Well, that's good, but it does sound a little like hazing what you just said.
Oh, no, it is. It is a little bit. It's art hazing. Yeah, see, it's hazing for the sake of art. You know what I mean? That can go too far. There's some Russian guy that made someone walk on glass or something. You know, I mean, you can't do that. Yeah.
You know, you take them out for ice cream once or twice and remind them that this is a glamorous business. Now, Christine, now you have been trying to make this movie for 10 years, and David Gordon Green wrote the first draft of this, and he intended to direct it. Can you tell us why it took 10 years and how different the project was initially to what I saw on screen last night?
Well, about 12 years ago, I read Brad Land's memoir, Goat, and was immediately struck by the story, but also I thought there's an extraordinary movie in this. I read it on a flight from New York to Los Angeles, and when I landed, I immediately called to find out who had the rights and found out they were available. And this is the kind of story that should have moved pretty quickly. You know, there was a young director screenwriter, David Gordon Green, who had made a couple of movies. And he was absolutely perfect for it. He sparked to the book right away. He wrote an extraordinary script. He was going to direct it. And then the writer's strike happened. So this was 2008. And then, you know, it was other directors kind of circled in, circled out, other actors. At some point, I feel like we had almost every young actor, you know, in Hollywood attached to it at some point. And for whatever reason, we couldn't get it made. And some of it was bad luck, and some of it, I think, was just bad timing. I remained absolutely convinced that, as Ben said earlier, this was a movie that talked about masculinity in a way that felt original and really not like something I had seen before. But at a certain point, we kind of put it on the shelf. David went off and did, you know, Pineapple Express and other movies, etc. Always, you know, checked in to see what was happening. We kept renewing the option. We got into business with James Franco and his company, Rabbit Bandini, and kept it alive. And then Andrew came into our lives, really because we saw King Kelly and were so impressed with it. And we started trying to get another movie of Andrew's off the ground. And at a certain point, kind of the penny dropped, and we were like, the perfect director is sitting here right in front of us. Andrew and his scriptwriting partner, Mike, took the script and I think in a really beautiful and brilliant way made it relevant to now, because, you know, Brad Land's memoir, you know, originally took place like in 2000 or 1999, right before social media started to define our teenagers and college students' lives. So they made the script reflect that. Andrew put himself into it in a great way. And that's what we, you know, went off to the races with. And that version, we actually got financed very quickly. David, I want you to add a little bit about, you know, where it went from there.
Well, also tell us, David, was it rougher originally? Was, you know, because I feel like 10 years ago, this probably was more of a deep, dark secret. Now, it seems as though this whole system is being reformed. How did it change? From when these guys got hold of the script and you all got into it and did your thing.
I think the movie became a little bit more verite when Andrew came on, and I think the kind of horror movie and the experiential point of view that he brought to it is really what changed. And I think what's a credit to him and to the actors is that it was there was a precision to making the movie. We had to count how many sips of water each actor took so that no one was getting sick. And so it was very technical the way we approached it. And the fact that you can watch it and it looks just like madness and lawless is a credit to all the creatives.
Well, now, all right, I'm watching.
Sorry, just a note on that, though. Right. Just to what you're asking, they haven't changed. You were asking frats yes. haven't changed very much. Okay, I don't think. Okay, I think there's been some movement, but kids are still dying every year. Okay, if you look at the stats, which I was given, but I don't remember them, but they were staggering, and it's like it, you know, it hasn't gotten better. So,
but
someone's got to talk about it.
But also to that. I mean, when we were trying to get the film financed initially, I remember a lot of foreign sales companies saying, well, we don't have this, you know, we don't have this in, you know, in Europe. And I was like,
Europeans are such liars.
Okay. I said, you don't have like clubs or organizations where men get together and do terrible things. I mean, doesn't every society have that?
That's like where it's, you know? That's like they were the original people that like really like took that thing worldwide. That was like their whole thing. The British Empire, I mean, come on.
Yeah, I think the Crusades was like one yeah. big frat hazing.
Yeah, it was, totally. Yeah.
So I'm watching this movie with this terrific group of young emerging actors, and suddenly in comes James Franco, shot out of a cannon, maybe right from the set of Fight Club. So now he's a former frat member, and he's all of a sudden he's dishing out and absorbing blows, and he's drinking and drugging and vomiting on himself. And can you describe what shooting those scenes with James were like, and how much of that was spontaneous? And boy, that guy is a movie star, but he brings some energy.
He's an amazing specimen, that guy. It's always all there, you know? And so we talked about it for a bit before he went in and then, you know, talked about it generally. And then, well, I'm on the monitor and they're all in that room. And Ethan Palmer, is my cinematographer, is sitting right there. Actually, Ethan was probably the most hazed person. Ethan, raise your hand. There he is back there. So Ethan was the only one in there, pretty much. And I'm on the monitor and he comes in the room and the punch me in the face thing happened. But then he just starts slapping you. Yeah, and I was like whoa, what's going on? And then I was like, this is great, let him keep going. And then he just kept going and going. And everyone in the room, I think all you guys were like, whoa. So that was a great, it was great that he did that because it really just like brought the whole thing up. And of course it was the synchronicity there because he's an obvious, you know, he's an accomplished guy and he's older and, like me, 37. He's not old yet, but anyway. So he, you know.
He's not old.
They were all, it was like, it was what was happening in the script right. because he was yeah. the legacy. Actually, for all these young actors, he was the legacy guy
yeah.
who was coming back. So I think they were all also like, whoa, like cool, watching this guy who's so good at what he does do his thing. So it was nice. It was a fun thing.
But he also delivers an important moment where he basically lays out the promise of this fraternal bond and security. But I don't know, he didn't exactly seem like he came out of it.
No, that's really the function of that character. I mean, what he means is that this affects the way these guys are for life. Like when you take kids at that age and you instill certain values in them and prey on their insecurities, you know, you're going to form, at least partially, those guys for the rest of their lives. And I think that's sort of what he meant to me, you know.
well, now, spend another moment, if you can, because a movie like this can be taken as a hard slice of life, or it can be taken as kind of a teaching tool. What are your hopes for this picture in terms of awareness of this situation, which you say is still out of control?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the first way to start dealing with any kind of problem is a dialogue. So I just hope that it starts a dialogue. I hope people start talking about it. I think that masculinity in general, I mean, this is not just frats, it's gangs, it's organized sports. I mean, like hazing is you know, it transcends all socioeconomics and racial barriers. So I just wanted to start a dialogue. Like men are really kind of, they're pretty fucked up. And like, they actually, like women, a lot of the problems that women have are because men are fucked up. So like, if we solved some male issues, shit would get better for women, I think, maybe. So, yeah. But actually, that's why, I love talking. That's why I think women's responses to this are good, because some of them are like, whoa, is that what it's really like? Like, I didn't know you guys did that to each other. Like, what the fuck is your problem? You know, and so that's good. I hope women start thinking about it too. Like, I see what's going on here. Let's try to work with this.
Like Nick, now you do that series, and that is talk about a visceral, brutal world. Do you kind of understand that whole sort of macho proving ground? Is that, you know, you obviously you have siblings, and I'm sure you guys have knocked each other around. Give us a sense of how your own life informed your view of this sort of visceral male bonding, and it, you know, where you have to basically prove that you're not some sort of a wimp, and how even your series kind of informs the way you process all this.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little more complex with the series, just because on top of the macho environment of being in an MMA gym with some really talented actors who are in incredible shape, you know, there's that element, and there's a competition there. But for my character, you know, my character is also gay and going on a journey of being okay with who he is. So, you know, you throw that into the mix as well, and masculinity amidst those circumstances and what he's going through, it really complicates it. So I think, you know, some of that was already in there, carrying it over into this this movie. And, you know, what I've been saying, which I think is the best way for me to connect, is that me and Ben and our characters, we kind of meet in the middle by the end of this film. You know, we start in two totally different places, and the way we see the world, even the way we are with each other and what we need from each other, but we admire a lot of what the other person has, whether it's humility or a bold attitude. In my case, you know, there's some version of this where we find a place to see the world in a new way and be the support that we actually need, not what we think we need. And that's a big part of masculinity to me, is who you can be to your brothers, both blood and, you know, in this movie, the fraternity and what that means.
Now, Christina, are we men as a species really responsible for all the problems women have?
Like, I'm supposed to answer that as to represent, all women?
Sure, you're the only woman up here.
Hold on a second. I didn't say that, though. I said some of the, but you can't, you know. Okay.
Look, I mean, my approach to the film was very much, and you know, I say this as, you know, it was a good 12 years ago when I thought, like, I got to make this into a movie. And it wasn't just like, because I want to show that men are the problem. No, it was because I thought I'd never seen this take on what it's like to be a man today, and what you know, exactly as Andrew said, what are the rituals, what do you have to do, how do you have to pass, and it isn't a world I know or understand that well, and I think it's something that deserves transparency.
Well, I agree with Andrew, we're awful. I am going to open up the floor to some questions, if you have them, right there.
Also, during this segment, guys, if we can wait,
we have a
question answer, we'll pass the mic to you.
Okay.
Hi, this question is kind of open to the cast. Either of you can answer. Did you go to any universities and observe or kind of have real life experience before you prepared for this role in fraternities?
In preparation for the role, or before we prepared for
it? Before
we even got the film.
No. Sorry, in preparation for the role, in order to portray it realistically, did you go to any fraternities and see what the scene was like?
We spent some time, we went out a few times with a lot of members of like the local Greek scene in Ohio where we were shooting. A lot of the guys are in the film.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just a good opportunity to get to know one another and to bond a little bit. Andrew recommended a few great books to read. I know, not the, yeah. But read some, read a few great books about things. But did you? Did we? No, not really. No.
I was actually on a college tour right before we did the movie.
Oh, wow.
For about a month and a half. So I was at different schools every Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And there was one specifically where I had a really wild night as research. and I don't really remember what happened, but it was great. Bowling Green, Ohio. Thank you, Bowling Green, for that great night.
Thank you.
Now, I noticed you guys, you tapped a few kegs there. What were you actually drinking?
Was it O'Doul? A non-alcoholic
beer? Something like, yeah, non-alcoholic beer.
So gross.
It was so warm.
By the end of that film, I couldn't even look at it. It was just horrible.
Yes?
Hi. Just hearing about all the obstacles and challenges you guys had to go through, it's really inspiring. I just wanted to know, simple, generic question. Do you have any advice for some young, aspiring filmmakers?
I mean, I always say, like, keep making stuff, you know? Because if you sit around and you're not making something, then you're not learning anything. So, you know, I started in docs, and, there was a great freedom to be able to just pick up a camera, if you can get your hands on a camera, and just go out into the world and start making things, you know? I think on the fiction side, you know, you can be making shorts if you can scrap it together, and I think you always can, and allow yourself to fail. And, writing is one of the really hard parts of it. So trying to get through a feature script and then really trying to get through two feature scripts is a great way to go. But it just takes a lot of self-discipline, self-loathing. it's horrible sometimes, but it's worth it. If you love it, so.
Thank you.
One or two more, right there. We need our guy. We're hazing him.
Thank you so much. Hi, I'm Lisa with Brit & Co. Nick, Ben, congratulations. I was wondering, you know, you guys talked a lot about masculinity and, you want to open up that dialogue, but personally for both of you, how did you come out of this movie? Did you feel different as a man? Did you feel different as a young man? How have you changed since making this movie in relation to that? It's broad, but in terms of your masculinity.
I reflected a great deal on my relation. I have an older brother, and just on my relationship with him and how... the maturation of a fraternal relationship, you know, when you grow up with someone, there is a shift when you become young men. And it can be really sad. It's kind of like a grief period of, you know, the people you used to be, the person you used to be, the person that your brother used to be to you. And you kind of have to take a step back and... It's a lot about, I think the movie, it's like Nick touched on, a lot of it's about acceptance, and a lot of times certain things you admire in your brother or that they admire in you, it's maybe not something you like about yourself, but because you can't see it. So that was something that I palpably came away with, for sure.
What about you? I think for me it was a little frightening how easy at times in the midst of some of the hazing rituals, which was really space given by Andrew for us to go and do some of the things that we knew were real hazing rituals, but just have the freedom to do it and explore. And how easy it was within that testosterone-filled environment and the energy and just trying to one-up each other, you see how quickly these things can get out of hand. And it was playing itself out in real time to me, where I had to take a step back when it was all said and done and decompress and say, all right, I get it. You know, I've now lived it, and something to be aware of. You know, you leave with a lot more perspective than you came in with.
All right, now I've got two final questions from social media. For all of you, you had to boil it down. What was the biggest contribution James Franco made to the creation of this movie?
Well, I mean, like Christine, he stuck with it for 10 years. I mean, obviously, he felt the material was interesting enough to to go with. I mean, I know at a certain point he had some actors that he was interested in having in it, but then beyond that, he just stayed with it. So, I mean, I think you need that kind of support from your producers, and like his scene's awesome, you know, but, you know, as a producer, you know, he helped bring the film along, and you need that. You need that kind of support.
And like I said, he was shot out of a cannon when he came on screen, and he really was like, wow. Now, for Nick, how does it feel to be acting on screen as opposed to singing on stage?
It's just too different to compare, I think. You know, I love both, and I'm fortunate enough right now at this moment to be in a spot to get to do both. But for me, it's about losing myself in the work I do on screen and getting the chance to escape into a world where I'm somebody completely different and with different life experience. And taking some of my own life experience and putting that in there is important, but it creates a really unique opportunity to just be someone else for a month or character arc over months, whatever it is. And I'm really fortunate and I mean incredibly thrilled to be a part of this project and really happy to be here.
Well, I'd like to take a final walk of shame and apologize to Nick.
Oh, never apologize.
And I'd like to thank our cast and everyone for taking part. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Thank you.
Guys, let's give one more round of applause for our panelists of Deadline Hollywood, the GOAT. Did an absolutely incredible job. This space is now closed. The space is now closed. Please come back at 4 o'clock p.m. to take place in our Opry Ski karaoke happy hour. 4 o'clock p.m. Opry Ski karaoke. We want to hear your voice.